Shalom, Israel. This is Bishop Nathaniel. I want you to know that you can view all our Sabbath classes live on IUIC TV. That's right. I said on IUIC TV. Download the app today. Shalom.
I want to start off by saying the civil rights movement was a hogwash. It was a piece of crap. Let's open up with the image of Martin Luther King Jr. As y'all can see the book, he's reading the Gandhi Reader. He was a disciple of Mahatma Gandhi, a devout disciple. Many of you and your mothers and fathers and the media lead you to believe that Martin Luther King was a disciple of Christ. He was not a disciple of Christ. You won't find his speeches going through the Bible. You won't find his speech, I'm gonna say it again, going through the scriptures. You see the Bible there. Is it open or closed? Closed. That was not the book that inspired him at all. You got many Christians of today who are claimed to be Christians, followers of Christ. Can we get that in Acts 11? Again, Martin Luther King was not a disciple of Christ at all.
Acts chapter 11 and verse 26. And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch.
Right. So the people that lived in Antioch in the Greek language, they called the disciples of Christ Christians. Okay. So the disciples were called Christians, not any old body that says, oh, I believe in Jesus. But the Jews that followed Christ were first called Christians in Antioch. Antioch was one of the capitals set up and renamed by Antiochus Epiphanes, okay? So, your friend, Martin Luther King, who claimed to be a follower of Christ, studied Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi worshiped idols. His god was Krishna, who the god with six arms, Spider-Man. So that's who he followed. Many of the black leaders of today are the same as the black leaders of yesterday. What do I mean by that? Meaning they full of crap. Whether they're black or, and when I say black, I'm including Latinos too. Let's go to 1 Maccabees chapter 1.
1 Maccabees chapter 1 verse 1. And it happened after that Alexander, son of Philip, the Macedonian, who came out of the land of Chittim, had smitten Darius, king of the Persians and Medes, that he reigned in his stead, the first over Greece.
So Alexander the Great, as the educational system calls him, Alexander the Great was the first Edomite to unite all the Edomites under the Greek banner. This was approximately around 333 BC. This is the beginning of white supremacy in the earth. Read on.
And made many wars, and won many strongholds, and slew the kings of the earth.
They slew, Alexander and the Greeks slew all the dark kings of the earth. Go ahead.
And went through to the ends of the earth, and took spoils of many nations.
They robbed many nations, come on.
Insomuch that the earth was quiet before him.
No nation on earth could stand before the Greeks at this time. Why? Because it was their time destined by God to rule. Go ahead.
Whereupon he was exalted and his heart was lifted up.
Come on.
And he gathered a mighty stronghold and ruled over countries and nations and kings who became tributaries unto him.
Everybody paid him taxes. Everybody. Come on.
And after these things he fell sick and perceived that he should die.
Yeah, because he caught venereal disease. He knew his time was coming short. He liked putting his pecker in little boys' butts. That's what he did. He caught a disease. Go ahead.
Wherefore he called his servants, such as were honorable, and had been brought up with him from his youth.
If y'all have not seen the movie starring Colin Farrell, look at it, called Alexander. Just look at it for historical reasons. I mean, and they watered it down a whole lot. But it's still good in some aspect. It gives you an insight into what we're reading here. Come on.
And parted his kingdom among them while he was yet alive.
So now Alexander had many generals, but he had four great generals. You had Lysimachus, Cassander, Philip, and Alexander. Cassander, Seleucus, and Ptolemy. Those were the four greatest of his 12 generals. Okay, read on.
So Alexander reigned 12 years and then died.
Yeah, he dropped dead of syphilis. There was no penicillin back then. Go ahead.
And his servants bear rule every one in his place. And after his death, they all put crowns upon themselves. So did their sons after them many years. And evils were multiplied in the earth.
So I want y'all to take notice of that. The Bible, God says evils were multiplied upon the earth when the Greeks ruled. That is the beginning of white supremacy. Okay? Now, I made a statement earlier. I said many of your leaders today are just like they were yesterday. Jump down to verse 11.
Verse 11. In those days went there out of Israel wicked men.
Notice what it says. Wicked men came out of Israel. Because some of us are under the illusion that Israel was all righteous. We were some of the most diabolical and wicked men on the earth. And still are to this day. But next to the Greeks, we couldn't surpass them. Go ahead.
Who persuaded many, saying, let us go and make a covenant with the heathen.
Notice what it says. You had Israelites that said, come, let us go and make a covenant, an agreement with the heathen. What I'm showing you is the Bible is relevant for today. Many of you on the street, you meet people, friends, associates, people in school, work, and they tell you the Bible is of no relevance today. The Bible is of the utmost relevance today because we're reading about wicked men making a covenant with the heathen. So likewise, this is what the book, The Covenant with Black America by Tavis Smiley. This entire book is about black, quote unquote, black America making an agreement with quote unquote, quote, white America. Isaac, read it again.
Verse 11. In those days went there out of Israel wicked men who persuaded many.
Notice it says who persuaded many. Many what? Many Israelites. Go ahead.
Saying, let us go and make a covenant with the heathen that are round about us. For since we departed from them, we have had much sorrow.
Right. They said it's better for us to be joined. Let us integrate with them. Go ahead.
So this device pleased them well.
See that? This device pleased them well. I'm going to show you the correlation of the civil rights movement to what we're reading here. The two go hand in hand, and I'm going to show you that. Come on.
Then certain of the people were so forward herein that they went to the king, who gave them license to do after the ordinances of the heathen.
Come on.
Whereupon they built a place of exercise at Jerusalem, according to the customs of the heathen, and made themselves uncircumcised, and forsook the holy covenant.
So our brothers forsook the holy covenant. They wanted to follow the Greeks in all things and exercise. Come on.
And joined themselves to the heathen, and were sold to do mischief.
We were given to do mischief. Now let's follow up by 2 Maccabees 4.
2 Maccabees chapter 4 and verse 7. But after the death of Seleucus, when Antiochus, called Epiphanes, took the kingdom, Jason, the brother of Ananias, labored underhand to be high priest.
So this brother named Jason, it said he labored underhand. You know what underhand means? Deceitfully to become high priest. In order to become high priest, how were you established as high priest? Who knows?
You had to have to come from Aaron's bloodline.
Right. You had to be of Aaron's bloodline to be high priest. So this dude, Jason, he said, well, I can't be high priest that way. Let me go and do this thing underhanded. That's what was going on here. Read on.
Promising unto the king.
Notice he went to the Greek king to establish him as the high priest over Israel. Come on.
By intercession, 303 talents of silver, and of another revenue, 80 talents.
So what was going on under the table, behind closed doors? Money was being passed along. Just like with many of your senators, many of your assemblymen, some of y'all think they get these things by voting. There's a lot of underhand going on, meaning money being passed here and there. Read.
Beside this, he promised to assign 150 more if he might have license to set him up a place for exercise and for the training up of youth in the fashions of the heathen, and to write them of Jerusalem by the name of Antiochians.
So that name Antiochians came after Antiochus Epiphanes. He said, I'll name these, the men that do these exercises after you. They will be the greatest Olympians you got. That's what he's promising them. Because he knew once our people got into the Olympics, we would surpass the Greeks. Just like you see today. We dominate every sport we get in. We dominate. What do you think NFL stands for? What does NFL stand for? Anybody? NFL, what does it stand for? No, Negro Football League. Because whatever we get, we just take it over. Right. NBA, Negro Basketball, what is it, Basketball Association. They said these dudes just take over everything they get into it.
Now, you know, our people are struggling with that analogy of the with the letters NFL and NBA. They say, yeah, oh, but here's the deal. Take Negroes out of those games and what you got? Garbage. Nobody's watching nothing. Okay, so...
Exactly. Where you at, Isaac?
Verse 10. Which when the king had granted and he had gotten into his hand the rule, he forthwith brought his own nation to the Greekish fashion.
So notice, it says he brought his own nation into the Greekish fashion. Remember what I said earlier. Your civil rights movement, or was, well, I'll throw myself in it too, our alleged civil rights movement was a farce. Just as this guy brought our people back then to the Greekish fashion, so did the civil rights movement. I'm going to show you that. Go ahead.
And the royal privileges granted of special favor to the Jews by the means of John, the father of Polemus, who went ambassador to Rome for amity and aid, he took away, and putting down the government for according to the law, he brought up new customs against the law.
Now, if you notice in this verse, it mentions Rome. Rome, these group of Edomites had broken off from Greek society and wanted to establish Rome as the next world superpower. Okay? So he brought up new customs against this guy brought up new customs against God's law. Read.
For he built gladly a place of exercise under the tower itself, and brought the chief young men.
Notice it says the chief young men, the chief ones amongst us, read.
Under his subjection, and made them wear a hat.
Now, y'all see that hat? That's very famous with the brim. That goes back to the time of the Greeks. It was called a hat of Hermes, where it had the full brim around it. Today, they took off the sides and the back and just left the front on. That's the hat they had us wearing. That's why every sports game, what do football players and basketball players put on their head? That hat. That is the hat that is renowned to be worn. This is what we're reading here historically. It was a Greek custom that they did this to the Israelites. Now it's called fashion. It's fashion. Read it again.
Verse 12. For he built gladly a place of exercise under the tower itself, and brought the chief young men under his subjection, and made them wear a hat.
Come on.
Now such was the height of Greek fashion.
So this sports league was the height of Greek fashion. Greek society. Come on.
An increase of heathenish manners.
And what came along with that?
Increase of heathenish manners.
Heathenish manners, because by us following their fashions, meaning the way we dress, let's examine that. Greeks wore togas. Y'all familiar with togas? They just simplified it and called them things mini skirts. Many of them, oh, I want to wear a mini skirt. What is that? Greek fashion. Greek fashion. The baseball cap, Greek fashion. All these things, and many of the things that we wear, goes back to the customs of the heathens. Read it again, Isaac.
Now such was the height of Greek fashions, an increase of heathenish manners.
Heathenish manners. Now came the foods we ate. The way we spoke, everything became like the tapping one another on the butt when you score. That's a heathen custom. The Greeks did that. What? That was the booty call. Smack him on the butt. I just tapped him on the butt. He didn't flinch. I guess he liked it. I think he did. All that was heathenish customs. What we're reading, heathenish manners.
Also, the hairstyles. The men start wearing their hair like effeminate. That's what Paul was addressing in 1 Corinthians 11. And the shaving of the face. The whole no beard in your face. That's all Greek custom also. And that line, the chin strap. That also. All that's from Greek customs. You see, a lot of the sports players have their heads bald and no beard in their face. Okay? So that's where that came from also.
A tap on a butt leads to the squeeze of a butt. That leads to shower room. Sandusky. What they said. Yeah. What verse you had, Isaac?
Verse 13.
You didn't notice a lot of football and coming out the closet now. I held it in for so long. The hell is this? All of that goes back to what we're reading. Go ahead.
Through the exceeding profaneness of Jason, that ungodly wretch, and no high priest, that the priest had no courage to serve anymore at the altar.
So the priest of God, the Levitical priest, had no more courage to serve at the altar of the Most High. Come on.
But despising the temple.
They started to despise the temple of God. They were raised up in this, and they started to despise the customs of God. Go ahead.
And neglecting the sacrifices, hastened to be partakers of the unlawful allowance in the place of exercise, after the game of discus called them forth.
You got to ask yourself, why would the word hasten, meaning they rushed, to be partakers of the unlawful allowance in the place of exercise? Why would they rush? Why would they hasten to play in those games? Anybody got an idea?
Money and women.
Right. I call it the three F's. Fame, fortune, and females. That's why they rushed. And there's no difference today. A lot of our brothers Cubans will die on a raft to get over here to America and play in baseball. They on a raft that they made from a bamboo tree, and they died in the middle of the ocean just to get here to play baseball. Why? Fame, fortune, and females. So yeah, well, they get women where they're at. Yeah, they get women, but they don't got that fame and fortune. You know what fame is? You got thousands of people cheering your name. You know what kind of adrenaline rush you get? Everybody's chanting your name. That's a rush for you right there. Then you got women throwing their drawers at you. Ah, yeah. Then when you win the game, the fortune you get, they call today endorsements. Pepsi is going to endorse you. Millions of dollars. Just go on in and say you like, just say what? I like Pepsi. Pepsi does you right. That's all you got to say. $1 million. Bam. Tiger Woods. All of our people in that. And then what do they all do? What's the Greek? What is the Greek fashion of what our people do once they get fame and fortune? They marry that white woman, that middle-class white woman, the trophy wife. He had the black or Latin woman all his life. He don't want her no more. Why? They say, look, lost your name, Raheem. Look, Raheem, you are the top athlete. Now, that little pickaninny you got back there with the nappy head, you can't be bringing up around here. She gonna embarrass us. She don't know how to talk. She don't know how to look at her. She don't even fit in. She can't even hold a conversation. Listen, we got a group of white women out here. You're gonna find yourself one. All right? You're gonna settle down with her. You want this money, you're gonna do what we say. That way when we all get together, we all have a good time. Yeah, sir. And he does that. Why? And then what happens? It's all a scam. The whole thing's a scam. Yeah. She gonna divorce him, take her money back to daddy, not for them little kids she had from him. Maybe she might have one or two, but she gonna bring it to her family. Or if she don't divorce him, he gonna drop dead like them football players. All jacked up. What's that stuff they was injecting in them? All them steroids and something else for pain. What is it called? The cortisone and what else? Amphetamines. They showed you that in that movie, Any Given Sunday. And a lot of them, knees is all jacked up, elbows. Some of y'all, before y'all came in here, some of y'all online, we the people in Connecticut, remember the boy, brother, training his son from the age of 4 to join in the reindeer games. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. He got him week after week, day after day, practicing basketball, practicing baseball. Just why? He said, we going to make it. And he ain't the only family. There's a lot of black and Latino families who train their sons up, and now their daughters, in that thing. Into that thing. What verse you at, Isaac?
Verse 15.
Come on.
Not setting by the honors of their fathers.
Now, look at this. Pay close attention. Not setting by the honors of their fathers, the Israelite fathers. Go ahead.
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
Read that verse again. That part, that line, that precept.
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
But liking the what?
The glory.
The glory of the Grecians best of all. What is that called? That's called assimilation. Judah, Benjamin, and Levi. These are the things you'll hear their men say. I don't like a black woman without either a perm or a weave in her hair. If you hear a brother say that, guess what? He's assimilated. His mind, read that again, Isaac.
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
Right. That's one of the, that's why a lot of sisters is messed up behind that. Because women will dress and conduct themselves more or less the way the man likes them to be. But if the man like, oh, I don't, that Afro stuff, no, that ain't happening. That's ugly. So my hair's ugly. But remember, I don't know if y'all was around during the 70s. That was the style. Some of y'all are too young to know what I'm talking about. All the sisters back then rocked that. Today, brothers go, yo, that's mad ugly. What the hell is that? Look at Michael Jackson. That's when Michael used to look good. He then messed himself up. Why? Assimilation. Read that again, Isaac. This was Michael Jackson's problem. Read it.
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
He said, I don't like my nose. I got a big, what's that? I got a big bell pepper nose. I don't like it. He said, I don't like that. I could breathe. He didn't like that thing. And I'm going to tell you why. The religion, his family raised him, and I'm Jehovah Witnesses. Every magazine that he looked at from the time he was able to look at, three, two, everything was that little skinny nose. I can't breathe. He go, oh, that's so pretty. The lips, no, them thick lips he had, no, that's ugly. Cut them down. I want these little thin bird beak lips.
Verse 15.
Read 15 again.
Not setting by the honors of their fathers, but liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
Notice a lot of these black Afrocentrics, they fall into this too. No matter how Nubian they are or claim to be, they like the customs of the Grecians best of all. Because they'll stop doing a seminar to go watch the game. Oh, the game is on! And they running. They follow the same. That's why all these black Afrocentrics, don't let them fool you. They're full of SH. Come on.
By reason whereof, sore calamity came upon them.
The Bible says sore calamity came upon our people. Come on.
For they had them to be their enemies and avengers.
For at one time, the man that we thought we saw as our enemy and we wanted vengeance on them. Go ahead.
Whose custom they followed so earnestly.
Whose custom we followed now so earnestly. That falls on us today. Read.
And unto whom they desire to be like in all things.
Black men, Latin men, black women, Latin women desire to be like the white man and the white woman in all things. That's what God is revealing right here in the Bible. This is another reason the white man said, you got to take this out of the Bible. The Apocrypha was removed from the King James Bible when?
In the 1700s, the Protestants.
Where is it outlawed at?
I believe in Jamaica.
Don't believe. You got to tell me straight.
Jamaica,
the Caribbean island. Why?
I believe because of revolt.
Right. Because as the West Indians started to learn to read, they were reading the Bible. And they said the Book of Maccabees was used as inspiration to revolt. And they were called what? What were they called? Who knows? Give me a hand. Give me all the way in the back, Jalel.
The Maroons.
Right, the Maroons. That's who was using the Bible for insurrection. So they said, take the Book of Maccabees out. Take it out. They took out the entire Apocrypha. And It was removed in the 1700s by who?
By the Protestant Christians.
Right, by the Protestant white Christians. The Protestants, why were they called Protestants? Because they were protesting against the Catholic Church. Name some of the denominations of Protestants. Baptists, Episcopalians, who? Lutherans, huh? Apostolic. Yes, Adventists fall under that too. Anything that protests from the traditional Catholic denomination fell under Protestant. Everybody understand that? Now, Malcolm X interview at UC Berkeley.
I just told you a little while ago, these leaders that they call leaders, this included Lena Horne, this included Dick Gregory, and this included comedians, comics, trumpet players, baseball players. Show me in the white community where a comedian is a white leader. Show me in the white community where a singer is a white leader, or a dancer or a trumpet player is a white leader. These aren't leaders. These are puppets and clowns that have been set up over the white community and over the black community by the white community and have been made celebrities and usually say exactly what they know that the white man wants to hear. And it is an honor, actually, that they endorsed Dr. Martin Luther King and were against the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's actually an honor. Now, when you say that they also, in this same Newsweek poll magazine, I think the pollster said that he went into the Negro community and asked about the Muslims. And many Negroes whom he asked said, well, I never heard of the Muslims. Who are they? You know,
this is the rank and file we're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Now, when they got down to the rank and file, this was the answers that they got. This is equivalent to the situation in Kenya during the Mau Mau uprising, when many frightened whites in Kenya, Africa, would go among the Africans and ask them, what about the Mau Mau? And the African would say, I never heard of them. And the same white man who would ask the African this question and very naively believe what the African said, when he went to bed that night, he would lose his head. And usually the one who took his head was the same African who told him that afternoon he had never heard of the Mau Mau.
Except in the Newsweek poll, they used Negro interviews.
So that's what we wanted out of that. So he made the point that said many of the black leaders are puppets, either comedians, entertainers. That's what black leadership is. He said that's a joke. That is a joke. And many of the people that we idolize, our people look up to, are these puppets who are getting paid and endorsed to say certain things. Yes, Tyler Perry is a puppet. Yes, Oprah Winfrey is a puppet. Sidney Poitier, all of them. Lena Horne, Bill Cosby, you name them, they're all puppets. Yes, not Colin, what's his name? Yes, he's a puppet too. Oh, not Obama, yes, especially Obama.
You know, this subject and the this particular piece that the elder just pointed out to, and he's bringing you to the realization of what real leadership is supposed to do in reference to the people. A real leader is supposed to be able to look upon the plight of the people that he's leading, and he's supposed to be able to inspire them to make change. These so-called leaders that you have now are not trying to inspire you to change nothing. They're set up there to pacify you and to make you comfortable right there in the dead state you're in. Mm-hmm. Make you laugh, make you dance, make you shake, party. But they're supposed to, let me just say it a different way, they're supposed to agitate you. They're supposed to say things that's supposed to agitate you to get you to look at the reality of what you face, and then you're supposed to look to them, and they're supposed to say, okay, you're agitated enough, let's take it to the next level to get ourselves out of this problem. That's what real leaders are supposed to do. None of these Negroes are about that. None of them. Because like the elder just pointed out, and just like what you just heard on the screen, they're all put up there to pacify you, put up there to make you comfortable.
Exactly. Get me Kanye West, his video called Power. I want y'all to just listen to one particular line of his song.
Broken, the school's closed, the prison's open. We ain't got nothing to lose. Everybody, we rolling. Everybody, we rolling. With some light-skinned girls and some Kelly Rollins. And this white man world, we the ones chosen. So good night, cool world.
Anybody heard what he said? Zephaniah, what he said?
He said, in the white man's world, we the ones chosen.
Exactly. And that's what Malcolm was talking about. These, your singers, your dancers, your athletes, everybody that the media puts up in the forefront were chosen by the white man. They methodically chose them. And yes, that includes your senators, your congressmen, your president. Is chosen methodically by white society. I know some of y'all are mad now. I'm sorry. I can't help you.
When would you expect it to be sensible for your enemies to choose your leaders? I mean, just look at the common sense and just that alone. When the enemy sets up your leaders, that's letting you know that the person that he set up is set up to act in concert with what he wants to the detriment of what you need. That's the reality of that thing.
Correct. Let's go to Isaiah 56, verse 10 and 11. Now, don't misunderstand. Although we may point out particular famous people by name, it's not in a spirit of hatred at all. It's just for you to acknowledge it, and Lord's will, they themselves can repent. Because sometimes you call somebody by name, oh, you hate him. No, we don't even know them. We don't hate him. Give me that in 1 Corinthians 15. Who knows where it is?
Verse 33. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33. Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners.
Music is a form of communication. Music is a form of communication. The Bible says evil communications corrupt good manners. Evil communications corrupt good manners.
The elder said that music is a form of communication. How many of y'all agree with that? Raise your hand. Is there anyone that would disagree with that? Because I'll give you a historical reference to prove that music, in fact, is an avenue or communication. In slavery, when we was on the plantation, and you would get groups of us that would sing what they call Negro spirituals or sing particular hymns. And we would sing these things, and these things would be communicating ideas backwards and forwards. The so-called white man, he understood that thing, and he says, stop the singing. He said, because that singing brings communication, meaning thoughts are traveling backwards and forwards. Y'all might be planning to kill me. So he needed to cut that out. So in the reverse, he's going to allow the kind of singing that he's going to allow now is this rap garbage, because it is not designed to put in the mind of what we used to do back then. We used to plot to get to overthrow him. Now we're plotting to overthrow each other. That's what you just looked at, jump out the window.
Right, that rap music. Mariah Carey got in trouble because she made a statement and said the white man set up rap music to destroy the black community. Every rapper and his mama, beginning with 50 Cent, attacked that woman, and they made her apologize about that thing. But what is rap music about? The destruction and detriment of black and Latin society. Rape, robbery, murder, hatred, covetousness. You listen to that stuff, that's what's in your subconscious mind. That's what you like. Even if by your voice, your verbally, you may say, no, I ain't like that. But in your spirit, oh, yes, you are. Them seeds have been planted and taken root. That's why young boys shoot each other. Why? They heard it on a damn rap record. Yes, what you got, Bezalel?
When I was in college going for advertisement, they taught us that repetition is a form of subliminal suggestion. Right. So in other words, the more people see something, the more you put it in their face, the more it's going to be in their mind without them knowing it. And the same thing, it's parallel to music.
Right.
And music is a form of suggestion when it's in repetition. That's why the dumbest song could be on the radio, but they pump it so much that after a while you like it and you remember.
Like that stupid little, what's that Chinese boy name? He won one of those singing things, and it was the worst song in the world.
To go along with his topic, you had Kanye West again. I forgot, but Kanye West was performing live. He had Caesar on stage talking with him. Remember that somewhere on video. He has white Jesus on stage with him while he's performing. The audience is clapping, woo, Kanye West. In the video, a white dude walking around just in the toga, all of that, while he's rapping. People are clapping and applauding like it was really Jesus on the stage.
So these are your role models.
Kanye West suffered a huge wardrobe malfunction over the weekend. Hey guys, Dax Holt here. So Kanye West kicked off his Yeezus tour up in Seattle, and here's the thing. Walks out on stage, he's got a mask on, his pants rip open right down the middle of the crotch. Lucky for him, he was wearing underwear, but it didn't even faze him. He kept going, kept singing his song, just kind of held up his pants while his underwear was showing off to the crowd. And honestly, it was a pretty big rip. So he's performing, next thing you know, Jesus makes an appearance. So now you got Yeezus and Jesus on stage. They've come together finally. This is ridiculous. And Kanye, the whole concert, keeps switching up his costumes. He's got a mask on, switches to another mask, then another bedazzly mask. Honestly, I feel like I'd be a little upset that you go to see someone and the whole time their face is covered up. Either way, I am hearing that the concert is off the hook. Everyone is loving it. So, Kanye just being Kanye.
You gotta think about it. Because if all of us, the majority of our people, black and Latino, were well off, we wouldn't be in all of this foolishness. But I said that to say this. White society, which is white supremacy, it is methodic and diabolical. Keep the majority of the people in the midst of poverty. We could control the masses of them through things like music, acting, entertainment. Why? You got no money? Let's pull up a few of them and have them sing songs we want them to sing. Right, like Trick Baby. Okay, all of that is all planned. Executed lovely on their behalf. You got it, Isaac? Come on.
Yes, sir. 1 Samuel 16, verse 14. But the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him.
So notice the evil spirit. When you sin against the Most High, an evil spirit. Well, some of y'all got evil spirits on y'all up in here. I'm going to tell you straight. That's going to be a lesson for another day. But when you start to break the commandments, an evil spirit from the Lord will come upon you. But let's see what the remedy was. Go ahead.
And Saul's servants said unto him, Behold now, an evil spirit from God troubleth thee. Let our Lord now command thy servants, which are before thee, to seek out a man who is a cunning player on an harp. And it shall come to pass, when the evil spirit from God is upon thee, then he shall play with his hand, and thou shalt be well. And Saul said unto his servants, Provide me now a man that can play well, and bring him to me. Then answered one of the servants and said, Behold, I have seen a son of Jesse, Bethlehemite, that is cunning in playing, and a mighty valiant man, and a man of war, and prudent in matters, and a comely person, and the Lord is with him. Wherefore Saul sent messages unto Jesse and said, Send me David thy son, which is with the sheep. And Jesse took an ass laden with bread, and a bottle of wine, and a kid.
Can you get to the point, Isaac? Verse 23.
And it came to pass, when the evil spirit from God was on Saul, that David took an harp and played with his hand. So Saul was refreshed and was well, and the evil spirit departed from him.
This is how the white man knows that music can manipulate and calm people. Music has that power. That's what we're reading here in the Bible. Some of y'all listen to music and you think it has no effect on you. Music has effect on you. That's why when you go into any corporate building, what do they have playing in the elevator? It ain't rap. They call it elevator music. Calming music so that the nigga within you will not come out. You go in there mad. You get in that elevator, you all calm down. Yes, boss, you're right. You know, I do deserve to be fired. Thank you. And you walk out. You went in there to blast things up, and it didn't happen because that music calmed you behind down.
Yeah, the elder just made a point. He said that music is effective. I forget the words you just used. It's very effective, and there's no question about how effective the music is. Regardless of what kind of music it is, it has an effect. The instant way that you know for a fact that it has an effect on you is look how much they pay that industry. They give one person, like this guy that just put up there with that fake Jesus, he gets millions of dollars to do that because the result is worth billions.
It's the same thing. For example, I used to go to different Home Depots, do a reset. Every Home Depot don't play the same music. But guess what? They got the same owner. How come they don't play the same music? If you go to a Home Depot in Long Island, you play the same music from a Home Depot in Brooklyn. Big difference. But on Christmas, they all play the same music. Mm-hmm. Yep. But when it's not holiday, they're not playing the same music. So it go by, like Brooklyn, if you go like in Bushwick, you got Home Depot, the music they play is actually black music. But if you go in Long Island, it's not going to be the same music. So they go by what neighborhood, what people come in there. That's how they go by.
I worked in retail for many years before I went into banking, and Muzak is the company they use for that. And you would think they would play whatever music. Why pay all this money to Muzak? They put a lot of thought into that because they know that it elicits an emotional response. So they pay for this expensive subscription service. And when I would, to back up what he said, when I would work in different stores, different demographics, they would have a set thing, and they were adamant that you played this all the time. For that month, you had that music, and they pay a lot of money for that. And that system went down. You were calling people, oh, Muzak's down. Get the person to come in and fix it right away. Because they put people together, that company, and they pick songs that elicit emotional responses in people based on the demographics.
Why do you think there's always a fight at a rap concert? Because that music elicits fighting. Or what's that other music when people be banging with each other, Edomites, they be slamming? I don't know what it's called. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Right. Can I say this real quick? To the
mosh
point,
pit.
Right. To the point that Captain Joshua was making, he's making a point about how the people that's behind the music are psychologists. That's the point that he's making. The people that make the music are psychologists.
Right.
They call that
they're
the
ones
affective.
That exactly.
Affective domain.
Exactly. Oh, see, he got the term
for it. No, that's dealing with emotions. They deal with things in the affective domain.
Now, we went through all that based upon what Kanye West said about we the ones chosen in this white man's world. We also went to Maccabees and showed how these wicked Israelites made a covenant with the Greeks, which is the same that Tavis Smiley wants to do, make a covenant with white America, which is the same thing that the civil rights movement did, make a covenant with white America. Read that, Isaac, Isaiah 56 and 10.
Isaiah chapter 56, verse 10. His watchmen are blind.
The his right there is the watchmen set up by this system. All the leaders, black and Latin leaders, that they have handpicked and chosen, the Bible says his watchmen are blind. Go ahead.
They are all ignorant.
They are all ignorant. Meaning ignorant of what? God's word, his prophecies, his laws. Read.
They are all dumb dogs.
The Bible calls all your black and Latin leaders dumb dogs. Go ahead.
They cannot bark.
They cannot bark, meaning warn the people for the impending destruction that's coming. Go ahead.
Sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber.
These people love to slumber and sleep. Why? Because they're in the midst of what? They have wealth. They have wealth. They have, what's the other word? Fortune. They have a status. Thank you. Come on.
Yay. They are greedy dogs.
Now the Bible, God says, and they're greedy dogs. Not only are they lazy dogs that can't bark, loving to slumber, but they're greedy. Greedy for what? Greedy for self-gain. Go ahead.
Which can never have enough.
And they can never have enough. That's why you see a lot of black assemblymen getting arrested, black senators getting arrested. It's not that the white ones are not doing it. They got it more in on the black ones. Or they use the money for what? For themselves? Lock them up. Come on.
And they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way.
They all look to their own way. Go ahead.
Every one for his gain. From his quarter.
From his quarter. Because every assemblyman is over a particular quarter in the city. Everyone looks to their own quarter. So now, I made this real quick. Go to Jeremiah 6:13. Jeremiah 6:13 for your black and Latin leaders. This is why things can never be accomplished. There is no change for the masses of the people. I'll word it like that for a reason. For the masses of the people, there is no change.
Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 13.
Look what God says about our people.
For from the least of them,
go ahead.
Even unto the greatest of them.
Even unto the greatest of them. Listen good.
Everyone
is given to covetousness. Meaning, I want, I need. Give me. You do you, I'll do me. Go ahead.
And from the prophet, even unto the priest, every one dealeth falsely.
So now Jeremiah even got on the prophets and the priests. He said, every last one of y'all deal falsely. Why? Because it's always about a dollar, how to get rich. So just like back then, the same is true for today.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 10 and verse 9.
Listen good.
Why is earth and ashes proud?
Why? A Negro's made of earth and ashes, but he's proud as hell and ain't got nothing. Go ahead.
There is not a more wicked thing than a covetous man.
The Bible says there's not a more wicked thing than a covetous man. He's going to explain why he says that. Go ahead.
For such an one setteth his own soul to sell.
A covetous man will sell his own soul for sale. Go ahead.
Because while he liveth, he casteth away his bowels.
He cast away his own bowels. So the Bible says this type of man, a covetous man, will sell his own soul. That's why there's always rumors. Listen good to what I'm saying. It's always rumors that men like Jesse Jackson, Ralph Abernathy, that they all had something to do with the assassination of Martin Luther King. There's always rumors that men like Louis Farrakhan and those men surrounding him had something to do with the death of Malcolm X. Right. All of them what? Got paid behind all these things. Money came. Why? Read it again, Isaac. Read it again. That's why it behooves us in here. We cannot be covetous. The Lord forbids that spirit in here. Go ahead.
Why is earth and ashes proud? There is not a more wicked thing than a covetous man.
There's not a more wicked thing than a covetous man. Read.
For such an one setteth his own soul to sell.
For such a one setteth his own soul for sale. I want you to let that marinate, meditate, chew the cud on that, and think about that thing. This guy will set his own soul for sale out of for covetousness, for money. Yes, that includes all your rappers, your ball players, your actors, your actresses. You know, when you look at a movie, they will play roles that can manipulate people. The music behind them, that's why the movies are nothing without the theatrical soundtrack behind it. It all plays a part in it. Like you look at some little starving African, and you look at it, at first, the first look, you'll be flipping channels, it means nothing. But if you pause and you hear the music, the violin, wee, 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 and you're like, what's wrong with me? Why? Because that music with the visuals will affect your spirit, affect your soul. Esau knows the science behind that thing. Okay? From there, get me Isaiah 28:14.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 28 and verse 14. Wherefore, hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men.
The Bible calls the leaders of our society, our black and Latin leaders, scornful men. What are they scorning against? The word of God. That's what they're scorning against. Just like Jason, that wretch, and no high priest, what we read about in Maccabees, who forced the priest to join in the Olympics. He was a scornful man. He scorned the laws of God. Come on. Y'all switch it? All right.
That rule this people which is in Jerusalem. Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death.
See that? We have made an agreement with death. The death that is talking about is white society. That's the ones they made an agreement with during the time of Christ. The scribes and the Pharisees made an agreement with Rome. Hold on. Give me that in John. Is it John 11? About the Romans will come and take away both our place. That one. 11, around 43, 46, somewhere over there.
John 11 and verse 47. Then gathered the chief priests and the Pharisees a council and said, what do we? For this man doeth many miracles.
Listen good.
If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him. And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
And the Romans will come and take away both our position and our nation. So who gave them their positions? The Romans. That's what we were reading about in the book of Maccabees. That's the same history. That's why the two go hand in hand. Many of your black, all of your black and Latin leaders, that's why Kanye West said, we're the ones chosen in this white man's world, because they methodically chose the people they want to be in key positions. It's not by accident, nor is it by coincidence. That's why when Bill Cosby wanted to buy NBC, they said no. They said, we don't want a different perspective on the news. And he had the money and some over to buy the network. They said, no, you cannot do it. And nobody in black society balked about that thing. They said, yes, sir. And you don't hear no more about it.
But they didn't understand the importance of the need to buy that. It was NBC, the need to buy it. Because you get to put your own images out there that could change, can change the thinking of your people. They recognize that right off the bat. They say, hell no, you're trying to mess with what we put out there. We need your people to be stupid and dumb.
Exactly.
You're trying to reverse it.
BET at one time had a black news network. Soon as that was bought over, that thing, they said, get rid of that thing first. We do not want, because guess what? We don't, black people, I don't know if y'all notice it. Black people and white people, we don't see things the same. Now, I know half of us crazy in here, but white people will see something and see some evil and justify that thing. We don't see things the same. They said, no, we cannot have a black news network. Let them do, you could do baseball, basketball, you could sing and jive, shuck and coon. You do all that, be an entertainer. But when it comes to intellect, we cannot have you doing that.
You know the reason why the white people are comfortable in keeping the status quo the way they want it? Like, they don't want you to get your perspective out there, because they are all taught from birth that the reason why we're here is to serve them. That's their mentality. They don't have a sympathetic bone towards you for you to get your perspective out, because they were reared in thinking that the reason for us being here is to make America comfortable for them. We're the burden bearers for the real Americans, so you can understand. That's their psyche. Y'all understand what I'm saying? And they're comfortable with that. That's not an afterthought. That's just how they are. When they see you, they see servant.
Isaac, read that again, verse 15. Isaiah 28, verse 15.
Because, when they see us, I should say.
Because you have said, we have made a covenant with death.
So the black and Latin leaders made an agreement with Babylon the Great. Made an agreement with white society. That's what it's talking about. Read.
And with hell. Are we at agreement?
What hell? What is the hell they're at agreement with? Hold this. Give me Isaiah 5:13. What is the hell? Because some of y'all in here just now coming out of Christianity, you read the word hell and think, in the middle of the ground is a red man stabbing us with pitchforks. That ain't true. What is the hell? Isaiah 5:13. Is that the verse?
Yes, sir.
Come on.
Isaiah 5:13.
I want all y'all to listen good. So this is going to explain hell in one sense. Listen good to what I said, in one sense.
Therefore, my people are gone into captivity.
Therefore, my people are gone into captivity. Write that down. Captivity. Read.
Because they have no knowledge.
Why? Because we have no knowledge of God's laws. Write that down. Because we have no knowledge of God's laws. Go ahead.
And their honorable men are famished.
Our leaders are famished. Go ahead.
And their multitude dried up with thirst.
Meaning the multitudes of our people is dried up with thirst. Thirst for what? Thirst for knowledge, for understanding. Read.
Therefore, hell hath enlarged herself.
It says therefore, meaning because of all this, hell has enlarged herself. Back to the top of that verse 13.
Therefore, my people are gone into captivity.
Back to where you left off, where it says therefore.
Therefore, hell hath enlarged herself.
Hell is captivity. We are living in hell, but you think this is a normal life to live. The Bible says captivity is hell. We've grown so used to this life, it's normal for us. It's normal to see gangbangers on the corner. It's normal to see our people strung out on drugs. It's normal to see women going to the abortion clinics and kill their babies. It's normal to see your sons locked up in prison. That's normal.
Right.
God says, that's hell.
Right. It's not so much that we've gotten, that we've got used to it. We've been trained to accept it. That's what it is. You've been psychologically manipulated into accepting all the sickness as the norm. That's the deal. You don't realize you're sick. Our people don't. The disease is so bad that we don't even recognize it.
Exactly.
We actually think it's normal to live this way.
Now, y'all showed me this film a couple of weeks ago, and this thing stuck in my spirit for so long, I had played in for them in Oklahoma. They were shocked at this thing. I want y'all to listen good to this again about your black leaders and Latin leaders. Come on.
You conservatives make a mistake. You can't afford to strangle hope in people. Without hope, people become dangerous.
No, Howard, you liberals have let them invade our society. You give them jobs, political jobs.
Paul, you missed the point. It's only the smart ones we move up.
That makes it even worse.
Oh, no, we have to move them up. If we leave a smart one in the ghetto, he might develop into a leader against us. But if we raise him up into white society, we neutralize him. He feels compelled to try to act like us. He loses his identity and his racial anger, if he has any. He becomes alien to his brothers. They realize he sold them out and they grow to hate him. He becomes worthless to them and safe for us. No, thank you. In fact, in his love for the creature comforts, except for his color, he's become one of us.
I want to mention something about movies in general. I want y'all to hear me well. A lot of times we'll make references about like the lessons that we're bringing out, and we'll actually bring up movies that will illustrate what we're bringing out. And the question may come to your mind, how is it that our enemies actually put truth in movies? Some of y'all might think that way, right? Some of y'all kind of probably wondered that. I know I would wonder it. What is it? Why would they do this? Because they do it very small. They put a little small. The rest of the movie be garbage. Right. But they put a little not even a minute of some truth. In a lot of movies that we talk about up here, like 1492 and a whole lot of other movies, they put a little bit of truth in it. Why do they do that? I'm going to tell you why. Because what they do is that they put that in there and they test the reaction of the people. That's how, listen good. Because how do you think the American school system set up their curriculum? Because the whole idea of all of the educating mediums in the society is designed to keep us in a permanent underclass, for lack of a better word. The educational system, the monetary system, the justice system, all of the systems that you can think about, they all work together in unison to maintain a permanent underclass for the benefit of serving the real Americans, if you will. So, how do they measure which way they need to tweak their books? By testing the intelligence of the people. So when they put these particular points in movies, they test the reaction. How many people coming out picking up on what we put out there? Because if too many of you come out woken up, they know that they have to turn, they have to tweak their books a little bit more to put you back to sleep. Mm-hmm. Y'all understand? Our people are, this is an experiment field. Do y'all really understand what I'm saying? This is deep. A lot of our people don't think this deep, but people that run countries, they think like this because they have a society they need to maintain.
They got think tanks.
Right, exactly. Think tanks. They spend money for this because it's worth it. We must constantly monitor where our labor comes from.
Exactly. I don't want y'all to forget. Now, what he said, if y'all picked up on it, the guy said, you spoil them, you give them jobs. He says, no, we pick out only the smart ones among them. A lot of y'all wanted to know about Barack Obama, men of his caliber, like Kanye said about people being chosen. People are chosen. People amongst us that live amongst us are chosen. They pick the smart ones. He said if you don't and you leave him in a ghetto, he could develop into what? A leader. That's what they don't want. He said you bring him amongst us, you neutralize him. He said and if he had any racial anger, it gets neutralized. Why? Because you guys gave him a job making $1 million a year. He's neutralized now. He ain't angry no more. Just like the Geraldo Rivera. Give me some of those names. The young lords, the Latino ones.
Pablo Guzman,
they gave him all jobs. They made him top journalists. Millions of dollars a year. They ain't angry no more.
That's what the Bible says. A gift destroyeth the heart. Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad. If we leave him in the ghetto, he's going to get mad and do something.
Right.
But if we give him a gift, we neutralize him. That's his heart being destroyed.
Where did America get that from? Where did they learn that from? Let me see who's thinking.
America got that from Egypt in Exodus chapter 1. That's what Pharaoh did. Set up taskmasters.
That's good. That's a good one. I'm going to give you another one. Get Daniel chapter 1 and 4.
The book of Daniel chapter 1 and verse 4. Children in whom was no blemish.
Read the verse above it.
Verse 3. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs.
Right, because Daniel and them were eunuchs. That's what you're going to find out. Go ahead.
That he should bring certain of the children of Israel.
Certain of the children of Israel. Listen good.
And of the king's seed and of the princes. Children in whom was no blemish, but well favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge.
Remember on the clip it said we only picked the smart ones. This is what is happening here in Babylon. Read.
And understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans.
Y'all see that? This is where America got that from. He said, you pick the smartest amongst them and put them in the king's palace. Why? Why? What is it going to do? It's going to, they'll be used to what? A, establish Babylon, the system that they're living in, and neutralize any problems that may arise amongst the masses of the slaves. But Daniel, when you read this history, he was different. Why? Because there is a God. Daniel had such a fervent belief in the Most High, all his wisdom, he helped Babylon, but he helped Israel too. That's what Mordecai did. That's what Esther did. When you read about our forefathers put in these high positions, they didn't just use their intellect for their high society. They said, no, we're going to help our people. So that's why when we teach this gospel, we got to be aware of that, that this truth is meant to set the minds of all our people free. Okay? Why? During the time of Christ, you think he only had people of brothers and sisters of low class following him? No. When you read, you had Joseph of Arimathea, said he was a nobleman. Then you had Nicodemus, he was a Pharisee. Those were rich ministers. You had Zacchaeus, a high favorite tax collector that followed Christ. You had men and women that worked in Pilate's house, Joanna and Shuza in Luke 4. You had men of high status that followed Christ. Why? Because the way he taught, they believed what he was saying. That's why we out there, we got to teach at such a level, brothers. It cannot be death, damnation, and destruction to you. You got to first take them the way to try to set their spirit free so that they can see the truth. Not condemn, I'm going to step on you and call you names. That, the days of that foolishness, y'all, we must come on another level. Now, if they become a nigger against this truth, now we're going to get rough and raw on you. You want to get stupid now, huh? So, because sometimes you got to tear somebody down. That's why the scripture says this truth is about tearing down and what? And building up. Never forget those two principles. Civil rights. I'm going to just read through this briefly. Come all the way down. All right. Y'all can all look this up on your own. Council for United Civil Rights Leadership. Let's read. The Council for United Civil Rights Leadership, is CUCRL, was an umbrella group formed in June, listen good, 1963, to organize and regulate the civil rights movement. The council brought leaders of black civil rights organizations together with white donors in business and philanthropy. It successfully brokered the August 1963 march in Washington for jobs and freedom with the Kennedy administration. Now, I'm going to say this. As we go on, you're going to find out that the organizers behind this had nothing to do with the original march in Washington. The original march on Washington, as we're going to read in another article, was the youth getting together and stopping traffic in the airports. They said they was going to burn SH down. That was the original thought. But let's read on with this. The council encompassed groups with different strategies and agendas, from the Radical Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, that's SNCC, with Stokely Carmichael and others, to the Conservative National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Bear with me, I'm gonna skip all this, go up. Okay, preparatory work for the council began when Stephen Currier is a relative of John F. Kennedy. He owned a major hotel. President of the Taconic Foundation asked to meet with Reverend Martin Luther King. Now, why would Stephen Currier, relative of JFK, want to meet with Martin Luther King Jr. in February 1963? It said, with national attention on the Birmingham campaign, King became even more valuable as a high-profile fundraiser. Conflict intensified amongst the movement leaders, particularly between King and NAACP chief Roy Wilkins. Come on. So they were arguing. There was a fight going on between King and the NAACP leader, chief. To a number of close observers, Wilkins' anger and the growing appearance of interorganizational competition were rooted basically in the heightened financial stakes that had resulted from the Birmingham crisis. So now there was a lot of arguing between them about money. Let's go. I'm just getting key points. On 19 June 63, representatives from from 96 corporations and foundations met for a fundraising breakfast at the Carlisle Hotel. This is the hotel that Stephen Currier owned, JFK's relative in Manhattan. Look, $800,000 was raised. Donations came from the Ford Foundation, Rockefeller Foundation, and 93 other businesses and foundations, in addition to the Taconic Foundation. This is what Stephen Currier was over. That's JFK's relative. Few or none of these were black owned. At the Currier-sponsored breakfast the next morning, remember, you had all these people there. The Taconic Foundation's president recommended that the black leadership establish the Council for United Civil Rights Leadership, which, under Currier's auspices, this is JFK's relative, would serve as a clearinghouse for dividing large contributions among all the organizations. So this whole thing with the civil rights movement was founded on money. Now, let me see. No, it says no one dissented from his plan. The arrangement could lessen the growing internecine conflict before serious damage was done. Come up to here. The council announced itself on July 2nd, 1963, after a meeting of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights. It told the New York Times that it was seeking, $1,500,000 in emergency funds, and that it had already raised $800,000. Watch this. The funds would be used, said the group, to employ additional field staff to work in areas of greatest tension, to provide additional attorneys, handle the mounting number of court cases arising from mass arrest, and to strengthen the staffing of the seven organizations. Go down. Let me see if they list the seven organizations. Okay, organizations. The monies that they raised was distributed between these organizations. The Southern Christian Leadership Conference, this is Martin Luther King's group. He got a part of $800,000 to beginning. Not to mention a $1,500,000, they all got money from those 96 corporations. The next group was the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP, led by Roy Wilkins. The NAACP Legal Defense Educational Fund, National Urban League, which was led by Whitney Young, National Council of Negro Women, led by Dorothy Height, Student Nonviolent Coordinated Committee, SNCC, led by James Foreman, also remember this name here, John Lewis. He's still in the House of Representatives to this day. They all got money, they all got paid off. The Congress of Racial Equality Corps, directed by James Farmer and advised by Baynard Rustin. Okay, come up. In his first disbursement of funds, the council allocated, I can't even say this, $125,000 to the NAACP, $125,000 to the Urban League, $100,000 to NAACP, $100,000 to CORE, $50,000 to SC, that's Martin Luther King's, $50,000 for whatever, and $50,000 for SNCC, conflict within the council. SNCC, this was Stokely Carmichael's group, he had already left by this time, however. One of the more radical groups was dissatisfied to receive the smallest amount, but stayed in the coalition, promising access to large amounts of money, allowed the CUC, this is the council, I forgot what it stands for. We just read it, it's at the top. Who remembers? Council United Civil Rights Leadership, thank you. To regulate, large amounts of money was used to regulate SNCC, CORE, and the SCLC, considered the more radical groups within the council. Okay, later accounts from participants also described the council as competitive and harsh. What you're going to find out, there was a lot of internal fighting during the civil rights meetings. foreman of SNCC, wrote that the group felt like a jungle of civil rights hyenas. This is some cold talk here. Each distrustful of the other. So all of y'all, we always thought, oh, Martin Luther King. These dudes was money. Remember what we read in Jeremiah 6 and 3? The whole thing is fighting about money. Each agreeing to curb some of his hostility so that he could get just a little more money for programs with which everyone else probably disagreed. So they say, well, okay, we'll be quiet, but promise to give us more money. So y'all could Google this at home. This is one of the meetings. You got JFK there. You got, what's this old man's name? A. Philip Randolph. You got Roy Wilkins. You got Martin Luther King. There's John Lewis and all these Edomites back sprinkled in there. Y'all know Ruby Dee. She's the wife of Ossie Davis, right? She played in a lot of Spike Lee movies. Her, Louis Lomax, James Baldwin, they wanted to do a boycott on Christmas shopping. And a JFK and them came down on them three like a pack of rats. They sent Martin against them, because it tells you King and the SCLC initially announced support for the boycott. But soon afterwards, money got involved. The CUCRL announced its opposition. Opposition to what? The Christmas boycott. They said, no, that's America's big money banger. You can't boycott that thing. As we repent, I always tell y'all, one-third of Israel's going to repent according to the prophecy. And guess what? All this is, as you repent, how many of y'all shopping on Christmas? Nobody. Now, bear with me a second. Okay, the New York Times reported that Martin Luther King had second thoughts on a proposal and had decided to go along with the thinking of the other civil rights leaders on the matter. Nigga, you with them or you with us? He said, all right, give me some more money. Hit Martin off with some dough. He agreed with him. Come on up. Okay, these six gentlemen right here are termed in history as the Big Six. These are the Big Six that Kennedy initially organized. It says, not long ago, the black man in America was fed a dose of another form of the weakening, lulling, and diluting effects of so-called integration. This is what we were reading about in the Book of Maccabees when they made that covenant. And it said that they liked the customs of the Greeks best of all. All this is the same thing. It says it was that farce in Washington, I call it. This is the writer. The idea of a mass of blacks marching on Washington was originally the brainchild of the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, A. Philip Randolph. Now, this is what they lead you to believe. Watch. For 20 or more years, the March on Washington idea, listen, had floated around among Negroes. And spontaneously, suddenly now, that idea caught on. Watch this. Overall, rural Southern Negroes, small town Negroes, Northern ghetto Negroes, even thousands of previous Uncle Tom Negroes began talking, march, march, march. Come up, Abiel. Okay, nothing since Joe Lewis had so, I don't even know this word, coalesced the masses of Negroes. Groups of Negroes were talking of getting to Washington any way they could, in rickety old cars, on buses, hitchhiking, walking, even if they had to. They envisioned thousands of black brothers converging together upon Washington. Listen, here it goes. To lie down in the streets, on airport runways, on government lawns, demanding of the Congress and the White House some concrete civil rights action. That's what the masses of the people wanted to do. This was a national business, militant, unorganized, and leaderless. Predominantly, it was young Negroes defiant of whatever might be the consequences, sick and tired of the black man's neck under the white man's heel. The white man had plenty of good reasons for nervous worry. The right spark, some unpredictable emotional chemistry, could set off a black uprising. The government knew that thousands of milling, angry blacks not only could completely disrupt Washington, but they could erupt in Washington, meaning burn it down. That's as far as it goes? All right, there was more. The White House speedily invited in the major civil rights Negro leaders. They were asked to stop the planned march. They truthfully said they hadn't begun it. So when they sat down, they said, we didn't start this thing. They had no control over it. The idea was national, spontaneous, unorganized, and leaderless. In other words, it was a black powder keg. All right, here. The white man had plenty of good reasons for nervous worry. This is the continuation of the article. The right spark, some unpredictable emotional chemistry, could set off a black uprising. The government knew that thousands of milling angry blacks not only could completely disrupt Washington, but they could erupt in Washington. The White House speedily invited in the major civil rights Negro leaders. They were asked to stop the planned march. They truthfully said they hadn't begun it. So that's when they admitted they didn't start this thing. They had no control over it. The idea was national, spontaneous, unorganized, and leaderless. In other words, it was a black powder keg. Any student of how integration can weaken the black man's movement was about to observe a master lesson. So now you're going to learn about what integration does. The White House, with a fanfare of international publicity, approved, endorsed, and welcomed a march on Washington. Do y'all notice that? So the first plan, get on TV and say, we want a march on Washington. Then watch this. The big civil rights organizations right at this time have been publicly squabbling about donations. The New York Times had broken the story. The NAACP had charged that other agencies' demonstrations, highly publicized, had attracted a major part of the civil rights donations, while the NAACP got left holding the bag, supplying costly bail, legal talent for the other organization's jail demonstrations. It was like a movie. The next scene was the big six civil rights Negro leaders meeting in New York City with the white head of a big philanthropic agency. That's Stephen Currier, JFK's relative. They were told that their money wrangling in public was damaging their image. So now, the white man said, listen, you niggas, all your money wrangling is making you look bad. I'm going to read it again. You didn't pick up on it. Where was that at? They were told, now remember, they were at the meeting with the white man. They were told that their money wrangling in public was damaging their image. So the white man had to get them niggas in order. They didn't know how to act as leaders. And a reported 800,000.
This is horrible. This is absolutely
this is behind the scenes that they ain't going to put on TV for you. And if y'all get a chance, Malcolm X talked about this in his, it's called Grassroots Speech by Malcolm X. It's heavy. It's very funny. What was that? All right. And a reported 800,000 was donated to a civil rights leadership council that was quickly organized by the Big Six. Now, what had instantly achieved black unity? The white man's money. You see, y'all missed it again. What had immediately achieved black unity? The white man's money.
That's what did it.
That's what got them big, those six guys together and shut up. Now,
the gift.
What string was attached to the money? Advice. Not only was there this donation, but another comparable sum was promised. That was the $1 million for some time later on, after the march. So not only did they get paid before the march, they said, if this goes off well, you guys, you six guys, going to get $1 million worth after the march. Okay, obviously it all went well. The original angry march on Washington was now about to be entirely changed. Massive international publicity projected the Big Six as March on Washington leaders. They kept putting them on TV. These are the six guys organizing the March on Washington. And they were not the orchestrators behind it. But that's how Esau's media can deceive you. Go back, Abiel.
They were the face card.
Right, they were the face card. Okay. Massive international publicity projected the Big Six as March on Washington leaders. It was news to those angry grassroots Negroes, steadily adding steam to their march plan. So now the Jakes in the hood were like, what the hell? How are these guys the leaders? And all across the South, all the brothers were like, what the hell is this? We don't even know these dudes. They probably assumed that now those famous leaders were endorsing and joining them. That's what the young guys thought. Invited next to join the march were four famous white public figures. One Catholic, one Jew, one Protestant, and one labor boss. So that's why when you look at those marches, you see people with the union signs and all that. The massive publicity now gently hinted that the Big Ten is 10 now because the six got four white people to join them. Well, JFK got them to join them. The Big Ten would supervise the March on Washington's mood and its direction. The four white figures began nodding. The work, because all this is done on TV. The word spread fast among so-called liberal Catholics, Jews, Protestants, and laborites. It was democratic to join this black march. And suddenly, the previously march nervous whites began announcing they were going. Those whites that was first nervous about it, they said, okay, we're going now. We're going to join this thing. We're going to join it.
Why? Because the Negro were neutralized.
They were neutralized.
They were very neutralized.
Okay. It was as if electrical current shot through the ranks of bourgeois Negroes, the very so-called middle class and upper class who had earlier been deploring the march because they would say, I ain't going to angry march. Niggas burn down SH. I ain't doing that. Watch what it says. Who had earlier been deploring the march on Washington talked by grassroots Negroes, but white people now were going to march. Why? Some downtrodden, jobless, hungry Negro might have gotten trampled. Those integration mad Negroes practically ran over each other trying to find out where to sign up. The angry black march suddenly had been made chic. It's cool if you go. You should all go. Now Negroes say, okay, it's cool to go. We gonna go now. Right. The morning of the march, any rickety carloads of angry, dusty, sweating small town Negroes would have gotten lost among the chartered jet planes, railroad cars, air-conditioned buses. What originally was planned to be an angry riptide, one English newspaper, aptly described now as the gentle flood. Talk about integrated. It was like salt and pepper. And by now, there wasn't a single logistics aspect uncontrolled.
Right. A lot of so-called Negroes went to that march just for the simple point of just saying I was there.
Right. He says that
it became a status
symbol.
Watch
this. The marchers had been instructed to bring no signs. Signs were provided. That's why you notice they all said the same thing. Esau provided the signs. They had been told to sing one song, We Shall Overcome. They had been told how to arrive, when, where to arrive, where to assemble, when to start marching, the route to march. Esau set this whole thing up.
They were managed from end to the out. They were managed right. All the way through it.
First aid stations were strategically located even where to faint. If y'all gonna faint, y'all faint over here. Yes, I was there. I observed that circus. Whoever heard of angry revolutionists all harmonizing, we shall overcome someday. While tripping and swaying along arm in arm with the very people they were supposed to be angrily revolting against. Where did we just read that? We just read that in Maccabees.
By reason whereof sore calamity came upon them, for they had them to be their enemies and avengers, whose custom they followed so earnestly, and unto whom they desired to be like in all things.
Right. So at one time they were our enemies and our what? And avengers. We wanted to get vengeance on them. Now we wanted to be like them in all points. So now this is what this article is saying. While tripping and swaying along arm in arm with the very people they were supposed to be angrily revolting against. Who ever heard of angry revolutionists swinging their bare feet together with their oppressor in lily pad park pools? These angry revolutionists even followed their final instructions to leave early. You niggas be out the park by 0600 or 6:39. Yes, I'm all. We won't be out. With all those thousands upon thousands of angry revolutionists, so few stayed over that the next morning, the Washington Hotel Association reported a costly loss in empty rooms. They didn't even stay over. Okay, where we at? Hollywood couldn't have topped it. In a subsequent press poll, not one congressman or senator with a previous record of opposition to civil rights said he had changed his views. What did anyone expect? How was a one-day integrated picnic going to counter-influence these representatives of prejudice rooted deep in the psyche of the American white man for 400 years? Meaning one march ain't changing nobody. but black people think they did. The very fact that millions, black and white, believed in this monumental farce is another example of how much this country goes in for the surface glossing over. The escape ruse surfaces instead of truly dealing with its deep-rooted problems. Right here, the very fact that millions, black and white, believed in this monumental farce is another example of how much this country goes in for the surface glossing over. The escape ruse surfaces instead of truly dealing with its deep-rooted problems. What that march in Washington did was lull Negroes for a while. But inevitably, the black masses started realizing they had been smoothly hoaxed again by the white man. I don't think the young people today even realize this. And inevitably, the black man's anger rekindled deeper than ever, and it began bursting out in different cities in the long, hot summer of 1964. Unprecedented racial crisis. Go ahead, y'all. What's up?
I just wanted to draw some light on that part about how far this country will go. I needed the words up there because I forgot what it said, but I was thinking about the thought. How far this country will go to gloss over this particular thing. This goes back to the point that I was making about movies and think tanks. You know, a lot of people don't think these things exist. These people realized that they had a real problem on their hand. We got all these millions of black people mad as hell. What are we going to do? We need to first of all, find a way to neutralize that whole situation. They didn't just wake up and just come up with that. They had to do some deep thinking to put everybody back to sleep. You have to really do some thinking to come up with a plan to do that. That's not going to happen because they were playing video games. No, they were sitting down somewhere studying Negroes in deep think tanks like they do today with these movies and all of that. Like I always said, this man don't give a damn about entertaining you. None of these movies out here for your entertainment. None of them. This country don't give a damn about you at all, not even a little bit. Okay, everything that's out here is designed one way or the other to benefit them. That's why the scripture said this is not our rest.
This is from a Will Lynch letter. This goes back to what Yasop was saying earlier about our people complaining and then being systematically accepting it. It says, for example, if you put a slave in a hog pen, that'd be a ghetto just slums today, and train him to life there and incorporate in him to value it as a way of life completely, the biggest problem you would have out of him is that he would worry you about provisions to keep the hog pen clean or partially clean, or he might not worry you at all. So he was saying is he trained us to live in disgusting conditions as long as the disgusting condition was clean. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you live in a toilet. As long as there's no crap in there, you can live in the toilet. There's no problem. I'll take the toilet. You have the whole house. I'll take the toilet. That's what Esau did to us, to train us to stay in that mindset.
Exactly. Watch this. 1 Corinthians 1, what I say go?
Verse 19.
19. Babylon has their leaders and God has his. Come on.
1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 19. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent.
You got
to
see, the understanding of the wise and of the prudent men is what we just read about during that. So that was wise counsel. On the left-hand side, wickedness, but it was the wisdom of this world. God said he's going to bring it to naught. Go ahead.
Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God.
Right. The world by its own wisdom does not know the one true God. Come on.
It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
The Most High says, you know what? I'm going to show up the foolishness of this world with all their think tanks, their wise counsels, their astrologers and all that. I'm going to choose the foolishness of preaching to save the Israelites. The Most High could bring angels from heaven and do all kinds of things. But he said, mm-mm. The way I'm going to save Israel is going to be by such a low technique called preaching.
Verse 21. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
Right. So some of y'all might think preaching is a small thing. God says, no, that's power. He said, I'm going to show my power through the foolishness of preaching. Come on.
For the Jews require a sign.
Right. The Israelites that were raised in the law, they required a sign. Go ahead.
And the Greeks seek after wisdom.
And the Israelites that were following Greek customs that they loved so well, they wanted wisdom of this world. Read.
But we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews, a stumbling block.
Unto the Jews, those is even today, this applies even today. You have Israelites that were brought up under the law of Moses. We call them Old Testament Israelites. To Christ, to them, Christ is a stumbling block. They cannot see Christ in the Old Testament. They go, nah, this ain't right. Read on, Isaac.
And unto the Greeks, foolishness.
Those are our brothers and sisters raised up in American principles. They go, this is foolishness. This is not right. What verse you at, Isaac?
Verse 24.
Come on.
But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks.
But unto them which are called, both Jews, those who followed the law of Moses, and Greeks, those that follow Greek customs like we do today.
Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God.
Come on.
Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men.
Which is that preaching. That's the weakness of God. He said that's stronger than men. That's the power right there. Come on.
For you see your calling, brethren.
So you brothers got to see your calling in this truth. Some of you to this moment don't realize your calling. Go ahead.
How that not many wise men.
Not many wise men.
After the flesh.
Meaning these wise guys on the big six were wise men after the flesh. You got wise men today after the flesh of Israel. God has not called them. Come on.
Not many mighty.
Not many mighty. Those are your athletes. The mighty men. God said not many of them have I called either. Read.
Not many nobles.
These are your intellects, the nobles among stuff. Go ahead.
Are called.
Not many of them are called into this. Read.
But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise.
That's that preaching. That's us preaching the gospel. Go ahead.
And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty.
That's us preaching the gospel. Come on.
Go ahead, Elder.
And base things of the world. And things which are despised.
That's what he was saying. And things that we're despised. Nobody likes a Negro. Nobody likes a Latino. We're the things that are despised in this world. Go ahead.
Hath God chosen.
God hath chosen us. Y'all got to see this high calling. He hath chosen us. Go ahead.
Yea. And things which are not, to bring to naught things that are.
So the Most High is going to use us to bring to naught things that are. Christmas is going to be brought to naught. Thanksgiving brought to naught.
Through you.
Exactly.
That's the part y'all got to see. Through you. All this garbage is going to come tumbling down because the word of the Most High is going to be spoken through your mouths.
Our people crying and march on the street. It's our job as teachers to let them know when they repent, to repent of their sins and boycott. Because that's what repentance is. Give me that in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 6, 17.
Wherefore, come out from among them.
Come out from among them.
And be ye separate.
You don't see the power in that alone. Do you know the reason they got mad at Ruby D about Christmas? That's this country's moneymaker. God says, don't touch that. Come out from that. One third of Israel is prophesied to repent. And we're not going to spend money. We're not going to buy their DVDs and movies about Rudolph and what's their names? Santa Claus and Frosty. And Heat Miser. Y'all know that dude. All that foolishness we're going to pull off, and our kids ain't taking part in it either. It's going to affect society. It's going to affect the school system. It's going to affect everything. God says, I have the plan. Follow my plan. Y'all got to see that thing. That's why I brought Israelites in here. Half y'all ain't mad. Half y'all like, y'all love this place. If you could stay another 1,000 years, you'd be here. You staying. White man selling pizza, and he go to women. It's for the children. And when y'all read that article, you will see the people say, oh, it's for. I just got an email where there was a fight between a husband and wife. I'm going to read it maybe next week, where the husband is saying, my wife, both of them are Israelites, but she still celebrates Christmas because it's for the children. That same statement you see some of them, when we have the food, watch whose kids go out and buy pizza. Watch whose kids come back with sodas and watch the children. The mothers and fathers, the ostriches, are not doing what this Bible. Read it again, Isaac.
Wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing,
and touch not the unclean. That's what God says. You want to build something? You can. God's plan. He has a plan to build his kingdom here. Not here in America, but we're going to get our minds right. And then when that destruction comes, we're going to be that much more prepared to establish the new Jerusalem like the Bible prophesies. Isaac, come on.
Romans chapter 10 and verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
How can our people call on a black Messiah in whom they have not believed? How? Go ahead.
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
They have never heard. Christ, white woolly hair, skin like it was burned in a furnace, where the Israelites never heard of that thing. Impossible. Never heard of it. Go ahead.
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
How shall they hear without you, brothers? Some of us waiting for the white man. The white man is never. They spend trillions to keep this truth a secret. Our job is to break down barriers, break down walls, go into new cities, new states, and put this truth out. That's our job. Why? Because it is prophesied one-third is going to repent. And when they repent, they're going to say to you, brothers, okay, I'm an Israelite. What now? What do we do now? Huh, okay. Let's start setting up some schools. How about that? How many schools we got right now? We got 5 schools set up. That's not enough. Don't be satisfied with that. Because behind those schools are going to come other things, like restaurants. What about that? Where we could go and have places to eat clean foods. Stores where we could buy clothes that is 100%. With fringes. There's levels to this truth before Christ returns. That you brothers, that's going to show the mind of a leader. That's going to show the mind of being prepared for the walk to come on the other side.
The things that the elder is expounding to you is something that is called in the Bible vision. Without the vision, the people perish. So that's what you hear from up here. Talk about not only do we get the school set up, but each of the schools are going to have particular programs that are designed to help the people as they come in. That's called vision. You have to have vision. That's why we always talk about it. You must have vision. But most people think of this Bible and what we got going on here like it's the Baptist church.
Right.
You're going to work your ass when you get in here. You're going to work to get this work done.
Ruby D, I'm going to tell you a secret. That's why they did not want Ruby D and them to have a boycott on Christmas. Because the thought behind it was keep your money and you can do wonders amongst your own people. Imagine, in 2009, and the number's greater now, $9.6 billion was spent on Christmas alone amongst only black people. $9.6 billion? How many homes and houses can you buy with $9.6 billion? We could bring all our people that repent out the projects and have fully paid homes. But that's too, for no. But we're but
the
black
people. But the $9.6 billion went for them to buy homes.
Right.
While we stayed in the ghettos.
So what we're showing you, God has a plan for us. We just got to humble ourselves to what he's saying. When he says come out from among them, there's levels in that thing. There's levels that each of you as leaders, you got to communicate to the people that's going to ask you things like, okay, I'm Israel. Now what? What should we do? What's your idea? Huh? Tell me something. Because our people are thirsty for the truth.
Yeah, I'm going to show you. Then I'm going to prophesy. I give you between 5 and 10 years from now, we're going to start with us. We're going to start with us. You're going to see the changing. You're going to see how Most High power works. You understand? Because now it's a word to you. But we as leaders, we're going to do it. Where y'all can follow along. You understand? Because it's enough talk, like the elder said. It's time to put your brain to works. Each one of us here have a brain. So let's time to put it to works.
Exactly. Look, read that number for 2012, last year. Read
for
that.
For 2012, what is that? 946.
No, the next one is 2012.
Oh, okay. I'm looking. I couldn't see the bottom. That's one. What is that? 1 billion. That's trillion. 1 trillion, 37.7 billion.
That's how much black people spent last year.
Now,
look at all that money.
It's interesting to know something. Y'all ain't picking up on what I'm looking at. They've already projected that the Negro is going to spend even more
in 2017.
The year hasn't even gotten here yet. Their think tanks told them that's how much we're going to spend. You should be mad as hell. Yeah. And we don't. And out of all of them billions of dollars, not one of us produce a toilet paper factory to wipe Bobby Hines. I hope it's making you mad as hell, because that's what it's supposed to be. Not what we don't have nothing. And but yet we could spend this kind of money on rims. This is a complete slap in the face. And I want to say something else, and I'm going to pass it to the brothers. You made the point about Ruby Dee earlier. And you said that they understood the thought behind Ruby Dee's statement about not spending on Christmas.
And Martin was going to join with him, and then they told him, don't do it.
They said, don't get in my plans, nigga.
Right, that's all right there, right. Ruby Dee.
Yeah. Now, her thought pattern would have led to Black Wall Street.
Yes.
That's what they didn't want.
They
don't know what I mean by black. How many of y'all ever heard of Black Wall Street? Raise your hand. Oh, quite a bit. Okay, somebody tell me about it then.
Yeah, them banks set up lawyers, doctors.
Are y'all hearing this? Are you women hearing this? We've had such things. Y'all don't know the sound he's making, right? The ostrich sound. Is that we've had such things, but it's hard to even imagine. We had our own hospitals, had our own oil companies, our own hotels. I ain't talking about motels or a hole in the ground, complete hotels, bus companies, banks, six planes. Yeah, wait a minute.
Can I add something to that?
We had those things then, but we don't have nothing now.
Nothing now. Can I add something to that?
Go ahead, man. I'm getting
When you read the history, it said other nations stopped doing trade with the white man and wanted to do trade with our people here in Oklahoma. And that's when the firebombs came. They blew them, our people, to hell and back. And some of them are still alive. You sisters, I don't want to call you ostriches. You sisters, just go on YouTube and Google that. They're interviewing the children that grew up. They're old now, but they're interviewing a lot of the men and women. Listen to what they're saying so y'all can get your minds right. Y'all see that?
They blamed it on a white girl getting raped or something, right?
Right.
That's the same thing that happened in Rosewood.
Right, exactly. Yep, same thing. So when we're reading God's word, I want you brothers and sisters, when he says come out from among them, there's so much in that it will scare you. Come out from among them and be ye separate.
I got it. You know the reason why a lot of our people don't want to follow that verse? Because of what we read earlier. We want to be liked by white society. Mm-hmm. And once you do this, you're not going to be liked anymore. And you don't want to lose your white lovers. That's what it is.
Right.
That's what the problem is. I'm going to tell you straight down the damn road. You don't want to lose your comfort being able to rub elbows with him. Because he's going to let you know, damn, if you're not going to serve me, you're my enemy. That's the relationship that we have with him.
There was a thing on the news a couple of weeks ago, I can't remember it, a restaurant where, speaking of Bezla, I can't remember.
It was 24 African Americans went into a restaurant, I think it was a Waffle House. It was a restaurant, and a white woman complained that she didn't feel safe
right.
because of their number
right.
in the restaurant. So they waited 2 hours to get their seat, and before they even sat down, they were told they're not going to get served.
Right.
So they had to leave.
Exactly. We're almost done.
Romans 10 and chapter and verse 15.
Come on.
And how shall they preach except they be sent?
So once you recognize your calling, brothers, God is sending you. That's why I always tell y'all. Y'all are not meant to stay here for 10, 15, 20, 30 years like some of your fathers did in the Baptist church. You're meant to learn, get the hell out, and spread this gospel. That's what the disciples, Christ was with them for how long? About 3 years. Then they was on their own. They had to go out and build and teach. It's the same thing now. That's why we're getting 5 schools. We want to get more and more and more. We ain't going to just stop at learning institutions. Read it again.
And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel.
How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel. Go ahead.
Of peace. And bring glad tidings of good things.
This is the gospel of peace. Because right now, our people's minds, we're on the verge of insanity when you look at the conditions of our people. God came and gave us the gospel of peace. What do you mean by peace? Return to your nationality, your true identity. Then what? Then what? Let's establish schools of learning where more of our people can come in and learn. Then what? Then what? Let's get various things where we can keep the money amongst us, like they did in Acts chapter what?
Acts 4 and verse 32.
Listen good. Listen good. This is going to give us all direction when people come to you and say, now what do we do? Come on.
And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common.
This is Black Wall Street. They had all things common. Everyone was taken care of. Read.
And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus.
Come on.
And great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked.
That's a level we have not gotten to. Neither was there among them any that lacked. Because those that had things looked out one for another. That goes with love your neighbor as you love yourself. All of scriptures tie together. Read.
For as many as were possessors of lands or houses.
Meaning they had extra. Meaning they had extra. Read.
Sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold and laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need.
So everyone received according to his or her need. A family with seven kids has more of a need than a family with one child. Y'all understand that? You men must understand if you're going to be over congregations, because it's going to come to that point, come to that level.
Zephaniah chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together. Yea, gather together, O nation not desired.
So once you teach that, now that we're gathering together, here's the question. Now what? What we gonna do? The Bible says you gotta first gather yourselves together. Every congregation from city to city, state to state, that's what's happening. We're fulfilling this. This ain't talking about all the whole nation of Israel gathered together in one place. Because give me that next precept, Ezekiel 11, 16. We're gathering together in various cities, from city to city, state to state. Here's the evidence. Here's the proof.
Ezekiel chapter 11 and verse 16. Therefore say, thus saith the Lord God, although I have cast them far off among the heathen, and although I have scattered them among the countries, yet will I be to them as a little sanctuary in the countries where they shall come.
So in all the countries, which are the cities and states and places we dwell, Christ, the Lord, has promised that we shall be a little sanctuary amongst all these places. This is a little sanctuary here. A little sanctuary. But in this little sanctuary, in conjunction with the other little sanctuaries, we can do wonders. I'm going to show you. Matthew 5, 16. Watch what Christ said here.
And this is telling you that God is behind it.
That's right.
That's the thing you got to see. The Most High is behind this thing. And as we continue to build up, get these sanctuaries, like the scriptures say, that's only just the first step.
Exactly.
Once you get it, then we're going to have to meet the needs of the people once they come in. Right. What is that going to do? That's going to agitate us into creating opportunities and particular programs that will deal with them. So you can't, you at this level, you can't think about how far the vision goes. We can only see to a certain point. But when you're actually in it, then you realize, you know what, we didn't think about this. But now the need has come up, let's take care of this.
Exactly.
We didn't think about that, let's take care of that. All exactly. of a sudden, you're dealing with so many different things that because you made the first step.
Exactly.
And that's what we got to do. That's the reason why this program
I'm
is here.
I'm going to give another example. Read, Isaac, come on.
Matthew.
Listen good.
Matthew chapter 5 and verse 14. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle.
I don't want that. I want 16 about your works.
Verse 16. Let your light so shine before men.
Let your light shine before men. Why?
That they may see your good works.
That they may see your good works. The people saw the good works in Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4. They said, look. They're taking care of the Israelites. Oh, everybody being taken care of. They saw the great works of our forefathers. Was that it, Isaac?
And glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Right, and glorify the Father which is in heaven. They're going to thank God they recognize that they're Israelites and came into this truth. Let me tell you, Oklahoma. How many of y'all know how we got to school in Oklahoma? Nobody knows. Well, that's how we did it, because New York didn't pay for it. We said, listen. I said, listen, just I told Abiel, we're going to go see the spot. We went to see the spot. He liked it. I liked it. It's roomy. So he said, well, listen, the man said it's going to be like $1,500. I said, $1,500? I said, you know what? We got it. I said, no, New York ain't got it on its own. But collectively, I said, we got all these various schools. If every man gave $20, we'd have the money like that. $20 from just 100 men is what? That's $2,000. Boom! There's a school right there. We can do that from state to state. And if we can do it with a school, guess what? We can do it with a home. There's so much. That's what the Lord said. Gather yourselves together. Gather yourselves together, O nation that desire. That's why he said, come out from among them. Well, we gathered together. We came out from among them. Now what? Now let them see your good works.
And, exactly. And what you don't realize is that every time you do this, you're actually creating a better world for yourselves. And for your people, because now all of a sudden you don't have to continue to go to white folks. You can start to go to your own people. That in itself produces a chemical change in the brain. You ain't got to go sit up there and kiss behind of people that can't stand you. Now you can actually go to your own people. That's a good daggone feeling.
It is. I'll end it with John 8:32. We'll end it here. And guess what? By the time this video comes out, people online, other Israelite camps who don't have a clue will hear this lesson and be inspired and just follow our lead, which is our hope. Come on, Isaac.
John chapter 8, verse 32. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
That's what Christ said. You shall know the truth, meaning his laws, statutes, and commandments, and the truth shall make you free. That's what this whole ride is about, us being set free as a nation, the top nation upon the planet Earth. It's going to come in stages, come in increments. Right now, this is grassroots. But before the great destruction comes, like it's prophesied, and it's going to come, from state to state, city to city, the nation of Israel is going to do good works. You brothers, watch and see. You sisters, too. Watch and see.
We used to scream black power while Heron was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission, minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold, from Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone, 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are our men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.